losing sleep over shit. It's just going to make you tired. It's not going to make you figure out how to do it better.
This is Joe Wong. Welcome to The Trap Set, where each week we explore the lives of drummers. I want to play something for you.
Hey, surprise, surprise, look into your mother's eyes. I go where no man goes. One particular road in the hay happened one day. It only takes one to get it done.
You're hearing Surprise by Luscious Jackson, featuring my guest, Kate Schellenbach, on drums. A child of Greenwich Village, Kate found a home in her neighborhood punk scene, and she achieved some notoriety as the drummer in an early incarnation of the Beastie Boys. In 1992, Kate joined Luscious Jackson. Her agile, energetic style and lo-fi groove allowed the band to stretch out in multiple directions. Luscious Jackson broke up in 2002 and reformed in 2011. Schellenbach has found success outside of the music world as an Emmy-Award-winning segment producer for TV shows like The Ellen DeGeneres Show, Chelsea Lately, and The Late Late Show with James Corden. I spoke to her in downtown Los Angeles. And now my conversation with Kate Schellenbach.
My mom worked at many different jobs, but eventually settled in, she was the media relations director at American Cancer Society, so she did like PR, that sort of thing. And then my dad was sort of under functioning, didn't work very well at jobs, and was an editor and a variety of things.
But a film editor?
No, like a book editor.
Okay.
Worked at McGraw-Hill and worked for magazines and that sort of thing, but he also just kind of couldn't hold a job because he was just in his own world. So, but when they got, my parents got divorced when I was 8. And, you know, then lived in separate places. So.
Did you go back and forth between your parents as a kid?
I mostly stayed at my mom's. My dad moved just about like 10 blocks away from us. But I was living full time with my mom and my sister. And I'd see my dad like here and there, but it wasn't like regular visits, that kind of thing. And we were close, but we just didn't, it wasn't like scheduled visits kind of thing.
And this was, were you born in the 60s?
Yeah, 66.
Okay, so we're talking about, you know, mid-70s.
Yeah.
You're a kid in the village. What was your life like?
Well, it was pretty independent, as a lot, I think a lot of kids who grew up in the 70s, especially in the city, where we were sort of left to our own devices at a pretty young age. And I guess it's called, like, latchkey kids. But, you know, I remember walking to school from our apartment by myself at the age of 7, and like walking through the village and walking through streets of, like, you know, like kind of like what you see outside your window, just like downtown street scenes of like crazy people and construction and whatever. But
yeah, I feel like downtown LA is probably closer to what New York was in the 70s than New York is now.
Yeah, it's a little bit in stuck in a retro time zone back down in downtown LA.
Was your sister older or younger?
My sister's older.
And yeah. You were raised Episcopalian, or you just sang in the choir there?
We went to St. Luke's School, which is Episcopalian, and for the most part we were, up until my parents were divorced. But we participated in the school choir, and we sang at church services every Sunday and rehearsed many times a week, and were baptized, that whole thing. And then once my parents divorced, my dad stayed in the Episcopalian church, in fact married a Episcopalian minister, and my mom was like, oh, by the way, you're Jewish, so she's like kind of...
Your mom's Jewish?
My mom's Jewish, yeah.
Yeah.
And I don't think I had the understanding of what that all meant up until years later. I was like,
What does it mean to you now?
I mean, it's more of a cultural thing for me to understand that I have this sort of Brooklyn Jewish roots that goes back generations. So I can, I understand neighborhoods in Brooklyn and like what makes a good bagel and gefilte fish and that sort of thing. But we never went to temple. We never went to Hebrew school. Like that was never raised in any the Jewish religion at all.
You didn't have a bat mitzvah. Didn't go to bat mitzvahs or bar mitzvahs for any cousins or anything like that.
No, and I was raised in the Episcopalian Church, and kind of in the church we went to was very liberal and kind of it just seemed to me like a pleasant story with a lot of music and pomp and circumstance, which I enjoyed. But I never really kind of got into the whole God story.
You didn't buy in on a fundamental level.
Not really, but I certainly enjoyed the holidays and the celebrations and the music and the calendar of it all. I kind of liked you can look forward to Easter and look forward to Christmas and that sort of thing.
Who was your first musical hero?
I guess probably Blondie was my first as a group, and Debbie Harry specifically. They were probably my first and still forever favorite group. There was like a period of time between middle school and high school. There was like a summer where I went to camp and some counselor was playing like New Wave, I guess it was called at the time. So Parallel Lines, Blondie mm-hmm. album and like The Clash's first album and B-52s and all those kind of records that came out around then. And I hadn't really paid attention to pop music before that necessarily, maybe like the Beatles. But it kind of opened my eyes to, there are these bands and they're from New York. A lot of them are from New York, like Talking Heads and Blondie and Ramones, et cetera. And they play shows like blocks away
from
me. Yeah, blocks from my house. And there's still, that club is still open. CBGB's is still open. And Max's is like blocks from my house, like that kind of thing. And once I kind of realized I could actually see these bands or bands influenced by them, it really opened my eyes to what was around me. And so I think Blondie was the thing that influenced me to like, I could go see a band at CBGB's so I started doing that at like the age of 13.
When did you start playing drums?
Pretty soon after that. So the first time I ever went to see a live show, I was 13 and it was at CBGB's and I'd actually recently found a note that I wrote to a friend of mine like in class when you pass notes. And I was looking for something else, and I found a box of.
Wait, you still have all your old notes? From
I had like
high
a box.
School?
Yeah, I had like a box of like letters and just trivia stuff. And I was looking. It was actually the Beastie Boys are writing a book, and they wanted me to. They were looking for something, and I was like looking through this stuff, and I found a note. And it was usually you write a note on a little scrap piece of paper, but this was like a letter that I must have passed to a friend of mine, and then she wrote some comments and sent it back to me. So I had it still. And it talked about the first time I had ever gone to see a show, which was kind of amazing to discover this years later. And I was able to verify that I was 13, which seems really young, especially now that I have a 12-year-old at home. So I was like, Jesus Christ. Anyway, so I went to see this band called Student Teachers, and they were like a post-punk pop band of kids that were just a few years older than me, and they were being produced by Jimmy Destri, who's a keyboardist of Blondie. Mm-hmm. And I went to their show, and they were super cute and amazing, and they had a girl bass player and a girl drummer. And the drummer, this woman, her name was Laura Davis, and she had also sang in my choir. Like, she was a couple years older than me and had been in the St. Luke's choir. So I was like, everything just sort of like clicked. This was like my first...
Yeah,
inkling of that there was this scene and that there were kids like just a few years older than me playing music that wasn't that complicated. I mean, I think I came into music at a good time because I wasn't having to emulate like, Led Zeppelin or Rush or something. It was like seeing bands that were just playing kind of very simple pop punk. And
which I think is the greatest thing about punk is that it removes that barrier of entry of virtuosity. That's
for sure. And
most of their music.
And CBGB's where the stage was like just a couple feet high, and you could literally like reach out and touch these people. And at the show, also Clem Burke, the drummer from Blondie, was there just in the audience. Which so that all these things were just like, oh my God, I want to be a part of this. This is like amazing. It's like my heroes are here. This band is amazing. These girls are playing. They're rocking out. They're like a couple years older than me. They're from the same background. I want to do this. Like this is cool. I want to be a part of this. And I love music and grew up singing in the choir and piano lessons, all that kind of thing. I thought that this was something that I would like to do. And it was like, well, maybe I'll be a bass player. Maybe I'll be a drummer. I don't know. And then just somehow led to drums. So quickly after that, I feel like I got to sort of a ragtag of instruments. Like a neighbor lent me a snare drum. And then my mom had a big box. And I must have had a hi-hat. I don't know how I just collected all these random pieces of like a proto drum kit. And just started playing along to records. And like those early records were like the greatest, easiest things to figure out, like B-52s and Gang of Four and that kind of stuff. Just simple, repetitive beats and sort of learning how you accent something with a cymbal and how dynamics work and that sort of thing.
Did it feel like you learned all of that stuff pretty intuitively?
I think so, yeah. I think I had an appreciation of music from how I grew up and just having a sort of a musical background. And it also, it seemed like, I don't think I was like ready to commit to taking lessons and that kind of thing. And I didn't think the people who were taking music lessons or were in like school bands, I didn't think that was cool.
Right.
So I kind of wanted it.
Because it's kind of not.
It's not, yeah. So I wanted to just do it myself and also wanted to listen to music that I liked. I didn't want to have to learn stuff that I didn't like. So I just kind of, you know, there was this whole do-it-yourself aesthetic of punk and that era. So for years, yeah, I just sort of taught myself the ropes so as much as I could. And then I would go to shows just like all the time and watch the drummers. And, you know, the way I'd get drumsticks is after the show, I'd like look around the stage and try to see if someone's dropped a stick. And I would just collect like just stuff. And I didn't know what was going, and I didn't know what I was doing. But then another wonderful thing is that I lived in this loft in downtown Manhattan, which was pretty soundproof, and it was like funky people in the building, other bands and stuff. And a friend of my mother's asked if she could store her drum kit at our house for like a year because she was traveling, and we had the room for it. And my mom was like, yes, actually, my daughter's interested in playing. If she can play on them, then you can store them here. So around that time, like 14 or so, there was a drum kit at my house all of a sudden, which I had started playing on. Moved away from the boxes to a kit. I was asked to join a band for real, and that first band was actually the Beastie Boys, but it was a proto version, earlier version. I met some of those guys at a show at a club downtown, and they had a band called Young Aborigines, which was sort of like a post-punk, I don't know, it was almost like a jam band. It was like a kind of public image type music, just kind of long,
art rock.
Repetitive, heavy bass, scratchy guitar kind of stuff, with no singer. And Mike Diamond played the drums.
Right.
So I met Mike and John Barry, who was the guitarist, at a show. And they, I don't know, they liked how I was dressed or something. And we started talking. And then I said, oh, yeah, I play drums. They're like, well, why don't you come to a rehearsal and play percussion for us? And I did. And I went up and started jamming with them and playing with them, and I became their percussionist, which I had never really played percussion before, but it was kind of going back to like cardboard box and a snare drum. Like it was just playing on whatever was around and playing along with Mike. And then eventually that turned into what became the Beastie Boys, which was basically when we were done with Young Aborigines rehearsals, we would switch instruments and then make fun of hardcore punk rock and make up songs, and that's kind of how that that all started.
And how long were you with them?
Beastie's just like maybe 3 years, like 15 to 18 or 14 to 18, three, 4 years. And yeah, we started as a joke and then played some shows. People seemed to like it. And then we kept wanting to break up, and then the boys were going to go off to college, and we were convinced to record a record before everyone left for college. So we recorded this 7-inch hardcore record with like 8 songs on it or something crazy.
As you do.
Yeah. And then just kept getting more shows. Like, people liked it. People seemed to like that better than anything else we were doing. And then I guess also at the time that that hardcore scene was really starting to blossom in New York. It had already, like, it was in D.C., it was in Southern California, but New York was still kind of old school punk, and then it all kind of came and took over our scene. We were playing shows with the Bad Brains and, you know, Circle Jerks and all kinds of bands like that. But and then, like I said, Beastie Boys was kind of started as a joke, and then we kept trying to break up, but then people kept wanting us to play. And every time we wanted to break up, someone would be like, well, why don't you record one more thing? So then we recorded, like, another record, which most of the songs were shitty, like, pretentious post-punk drivel. But then we got this song called Cookie Puss out of it, which was this weird, it's not even rap, I don't know what to call it, hip-hop-esque piece of music, I don't know how to call it. Which is basically like a prank phone call over a beat. And we started performing. We had to somehow figure out how to play that song, and it became like, well, why don't we rap over the beat and rap about Cookie Puss? And then everyone started writing these raps, and we had to get a DJ to rap over the music. Like, it became this whole thing where all of a sudden we were becoming this rap group. And we'd play a show, we'd play our punk songs, and then we'd sort of switch gears. And we had to find a DJ, so we found this guy, Rick Rubin, who, as you know, has become a huge producer.
Who?
Yeah. But he was just like a college kid at NYU, had a turntable.
Yeah, and he started Def Jam in his dorm room.
Yep.
But he's a fascinating person to me. I mean, I've spoken to several different drummers that he's worked with in different stages of his career. And I don't think I ever spoke to anyone that was involved so early on. So what was your take on Rick?
Rick was different than anybody that we hung out with at the time, because he was kind of a meathead, which is the best way I can describe him, which was just like kind of a Long Island, kind of sexist, didn't give a shit, was into heavy metal, and he was into all kinds of stuff. But and obnoxious in a way that wasn't funny to me. And I had been surrounded by kids, boys, girls, who were very just open and easy and supportive and didn't give a shit that I was a girl. Like, it was never like
progressive punk kids.
Yeah, yeah. Never, and never gave a shit that I was a girl playing in a punk band called Beastie Boys. Like, it was never a thing. It was never discussed. It just was funny to us. But then Rick brought this whole different element of sort of sexism and awareness that was not cool. I wasn't into it at all. But Adam Horovitz and those guys just became friends with him and were hanging out with him a lot as he was starting like Def Jam and all this kind of thing. So
like when the Beastie Boys came out with that song Girls, what did you think about it?
I thought it was a hilarious like comedy album. That
like it was lampooning this culture.
But it was also the sort of fine line. So what Rick basically said to the guys, we started doing rap, performing rap. It was never my thing, honestly. Like, I love rap and I'm into it, but I just was not comfortable as a front person. I wasn't comfortable rapping. I didn't know what to rap about. They were all writing raps that were hilarious and great and funny, and mine were just terrible, and it was just not for me. And they would help me and whatever, but it just never felt comfortable to me. I just wanted to play drums. I wanted to sit down in the back and play drums. But Rick had this grand idea that they could become like the first white rap band, which was correct, but without me. And he was pretty much like, I don't like the way girls sound rapping, and I don't like Kate, and it's either Kate or me, basically, is, you know, the future of this band. And they decided to go with Rick, which, you know, the band became something that it hadn't it became something different than what it was. So they kind of went in that direction.
Was that heartbreaking?
Oh yeah, for sure. It was heartbreaking, and as much as the band was sort of a joke and we were always trying to break up, it was still like my band and my boys and my friend, and my best friends. And I didn't like the influence that he had on them personally and all that. But Jauch, Adam Jauch, he assured me that we continue to play music, that we just switch to a different name and we continue to do our punk songs. And then Beasties would become this other thing, which it did for a while, but then it just, they really, you know, they released that first album or this, even the first singles before that album, and became huge, became this whole other beast. And then, you know, I think that License to Ill is hilarious. Like, it's all the references are amazing, and you know, they continue to be hilarious. But obviously not everyone was in on the joke. And in fact, most people weren't in on the joke. So it became this sort of frat boy awfulness, you know, spring break, inflatable penis shit that I hated. But I love them. So it was like a weird, yeah, it was definitely like a weird thing to be, you know, love them but hate them at the same time.
So what was your next step? Did you go to college?
I did go to college. I went to Hunter in New York. I stayed in New York. Went to college, kind of like hunkered down, got serious about school. And then I got an art degree and started working right away.
What kind of art did you study?
I was a studio art. I was a painter and, art history and stuff like that. But, didn't really, I got a job out of college at a photo archive and sort of stayed in visual arts and that kind of thing. But, was playing a little bit on the side, but it seemed more of a hobby, I guess, for years. And every once in a while, I was at this job for a while, and I'd be like, oh, can I take a month off to go do a tour? And that's sort of around the time when Luscious Jackson formed and started playing shows and that kind of thing.
You come and get me when I'm all alone, on the corner just skin and bones, fever in and fever out. You're the swinger who brings me doubt. A lover boy, where you coming from? Down there, out back, always on the run. Cool, cool, deep blues. You're the shine on my shoes. Is it in the damp heat inside of me? Or is it in the fire that we collide? I feed you mood swing, but you're never satisfied. Is it in the damp heat inside of me? Or is it in the fire that we collide? I feed you mood swing, but you're never satisfied.
This episode of The Trap Set is brought to you in part by Colectivo Coffee, handmade coffee since 1993. Check them out online at colectivo.com.
So Jill Caniff, who's one of the singers and main songwriters, she and I went. She also went to St. Luke's, as did Adam Horovitz. So we all kind of knew each other from the village. As we all grew up in the same neighborhoods, and she and I were like in the same preschool dance class and stuff like that. So we had known each other for years. Gabby grew up in the East Village and knew each other from going to see bands and hanging out at underage bars and that kind of thing. And we had never played music. In fact, I didn't even know that those guys were playing music. They had moved away to San Francisco and started playing music together. And they came back to New York and basically called me up and asked if I wanted to jam. And I started jamming with them in different forms. And then eventually Luscious Jackson. They had actually recorded a demo tape as Luscious Jackson without me. And that demo tape, they did, the two of them with a producer, using samples, and it was kind of similar to the Beastie Boys, where it was mixed up of all kinds of, the samples were all over the place in such an amazing, beautiful way, and they were sampling records like, oh, that's that Honey Bane record, like very like obscure things, with like hip hop beats, and there was singing, and there was rapping, and it was just really similar influence to the Beasties, and they had given their demo tape to different people to listen to and get some advice. And one of those people was the boys in the Beasties. And Mike Diamond was like, we want to start a label. and we'd love to put this out as our first release. I guess everyone else I had given the demo to had said, you need to re-record this. And Mike was like, this is perfect the way it is. It just needs to be mixed, and you just need to add a few songs, and we'll release it. So that's when Jill and Gabby called me up and said, we were going to play some shows. You want to record? Do you want to join? They described it as an ESG cover band. I don't know if you know ESG.
Yeah.
It's a very like minimalist funk band from New York. And that's why I started playing with those guys. And then things quickly started to grow because at the time the Beasties were huge, you know, and people were very interested in what they were doing, and the fact that they were starting a label and releasing us as their first act, we sort of had this great built-in interest. So that was wonderful. We started, you know, got tours and playing and shows right away.
How did your life change when the band got really popular?
It was a wonderful adventure to do with your good friends and people you've grown up with, and see the world and see America and see, you know, everything.
Were you happy?
I was happy. I always say touring is kind of like working at a job but never getting to go home and then having to like spend the night with your coworkers.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, there's always some kind of weirdness about that. I think, you know, obviously touring is best for young people. And we were even in our 20s or like mid to late 20s, we were older than most people who were started out touring. So we already had sort of health routines. Like we need to have a day off here, or we need to
work out.
Yeah, or have a yoga. We'll teach ourselves. We'll do a yoga class, or bring things to cover these disgusting couches that are covered with God knows what in backstage, you know, backstage areas, and bring our own lamps and like incense and stuff, because, you know, when you start touring clubs in America, it's
super gross.
And worse in America than
Europe elsewhere. Is so much better.
Yeah, Europe, they have showers and all kinds of things.
And they feed you well, and
yeah,
it's more humane.
Yeah. So once as we toured more and had bigger guarantees and that sort of thing, you know, we went from the van to the RV, which was like a huge, the RV pulling the equipment, which was great because there was a bathroom, mm-hmm. and then everyone could sleep in their weird little spots in the RV. And had a toaster oven, and that was a big plus.
What was your favorite item to toast in the toaster oven?
We would do like, this sounds disgusting, but we'd do vegan hot dogs, and I wasn't vegan, but they were vegetarian, so we always had to like compromise. Hot dogs was a popular
one. I ate so many of those things.
And buns. Then the tour bus days, that was kind of the best, because then we all get our bunks, and then, you know, it just became, I think, you know, the more you have, somebody in our band once said, touring is basically about schlepping and how mm-hmm. it's all a big schlep. And so the more money, the higher class schlepping you can do. So you can stay you can get your own hotel room, or you get your tour bus, or you get a couple of tour buses, that kind of thing. So it's all about the grade of schlep. So as the grade of schlep went up, the lifestyle was more fun. But we also played, like, I think we're the only band that did both Lollapalooza and Lilith Fair, which is kind of the huge tours in the 90s. So
why did you split up?
Well, we had kind of risen in popularity and success, and we're able to continue like our artistic vision and grow, and we started recording with producers, and we record in other places, and that, you know, it was very satisfying. And we had a great band. We had side musicians who played with us, and we were sort of at the top of our game. And we did Lilith Fair, which was amazing, playing with all these incredible artists who were really inspirational to us. And it was also a beautiful, beautifully run tour, backstage and everything.
I imagine it must have been like the cleanest.
Oh, it was the best. It was like relaxing, and there wasn't like this crazy. We did tours where there was like the security was, there were like crazy, like, you know, Israeli military people who were like, wouldn't let us go from, we could only be in backstage or on stage.
What tour was that?
We toured with Live. We opened for them for a while.
And they had Israeli
they had some
soldiers?
Crazy security detail because the singer had been had gotten some death threats for some reason. I can't remember
Someone
why.
Someone was trying to chop off his rat tail.
Something to do with some kind of Middle Eastern influence that was on, whatever. They did that huge album with all the hits, and then they did a follow-up, which is the tour that we went on with them, and the singer had some issues with security. So we were on this tour opening for them, and they were also, this album, I don't know that it bombed, but it was kind of...
It didn't sell 80 million records.
Yeah, it was dying along the way.
Yeah.
And the shows were getting downgraded, you know, which is when you go from a bigger venue to a smaller mm-hmm. venue. So it was all kind of depressing. But also the security was insane, where literally, like, our backstage pass were like, wouldn't allow us to be anywhere except for in our dressing room or on stage performing. So that was a really not a great place to be. But unlike Lilith Fair, which was this very, like a camp vibe, where everyone's door was open and you could jam with Chrissy Hynde for the Pretenders, or Stevie Nicks is over there, or there's, of course, Sarah McLachlan and... Sheryl Crow wants you to come and jam with her on stage. Like, just, like, whatever. It was awesome.
Felt like more of a community.
For sure. With, like, incredible food and a yoga class and people's
dogs. That's what I call high-class schlepping.
That's very high-class schlepping. But by the time that was done, we released our last album on Capitol, which is called Electric Honey. We were proud of it. We got to work with Tony Visconti on mm-hmm. a couple of songs, a great David Bowie producer. And
great bass player, too.
Yes, and also, who else did we work with? I don't know, just a bunch of different people. Debbie Harry sang on the album. And Capitol went through some sort of personnel change. It's kind of when, I guess...
The standard major label story?
Yeah, and... Also, there was this sort of strange backlash against Lilith Fair and that whole female. There was like all these.
That's
like,
weird now to think about, but I remember that.
Yeah, so there had been all these alternative rock stations that also had like female alternative rock oriented. Not that that's.
It was a format for like 3 years where. Yes.
And that's not necessarily where we wanted to live. I mean, we were considered ourselves a pop band or like an alternative pop band. But then all of a sudden the formats were changing and our main A&R person left Capitol and they were just sort of like, we're done promoting this record. We're not going to give you any more money to do a video or promote it at radio. And, you know, we're just shuffling things around and we were getting lost in the mix. And then also radio just stopped playing women. They just stopped playing female artists or female singers. The alt rock station would play garbage, but we're playing garbage. We're not going to play Luscious Jackson 2, or we're playing I don't know, No Doubt or something, whatever. There was just like there's not room for more than one female singer on the radio, and all of these things just sort of became super depressing, and we felt like we were just spinning our wheels, and we were also finding it hard to make a living. Like mm-hmm. we weren't like road dogs where we'd go out there for a year and tour. Where I guess is that's how people make the majority of their money. We were in debt to the record company for advances, just to make our records and advances on publishing. But there was just no way to recoup unless we had, you know, a number one hit. Like it just, and we weren't that band. I mean, we had like a top 40 song and Luscious Naked Eye,
mm-hmm.
but it wasn't enough to, you know, pay off or recoup. So I think. Jill Kniff sort of was like, I'm frustrated. I want to start having kids. I'm not enjoying being on the road. Like just, and she kind of called it, and we were just like, all right. And then that sort of 2000, that's when Korn and Limp Bizkit and Woodstock and all that shit came around and kind of just pooped on music for a while.
Felt the guys who tried to commit suicide, a soft rock head, bloodshot eyes, tis like Marlboro cigarettes, Reese's peanut butter cups, a Pepsi in his hand, getting off the school bus, failing drills, safety illustrations, crushed cars, driver education. Driver education.
This episode of The Trap Set is brought to you in part by Merge Records, the label that over the last 25 years has been home to many great bands, including The Magnetic Fields, Spoon, and Neutral Milk Hotel. Check out recent releases by Y-Oak, Superchunk, Tracy Thorn, Titus Andronicus, and Ought. Listeners of this podcast get 20% off any order by visiting mergerecords.com and using coupon code TRAPSET. As always, domestic shipping is free. Again, go to mergerecords.com and enter TRAPSET at checkout to get 20% off your purchase. Merge Records, home of independent music since 1989.
Were you living in LA at that point?
No, I was still living in New York. And my sister had moved out to Los Angeles, and I would visit her here a lot. And I had a lot of friends out here. I really liked it. And then I eventually started dating someone out here. And within a few years, I was living out in Los Angeles full time. Gave up my New York loft and my rent-controlled New York loft.
No.
And just moved to LA and have stayed since. So that was like 2002 or three. I did some recording with people, but it just—I didn't have the drive to do that. I took some time to figure out what was next. I continued to play, and I think I started playing, taking lessons again. And I was sort of like, "This is now when I can learn how jazz works, or whatever." And I still don't know.
So did you do that?
Yeah, but I still don't know how it works. I'm like with like Fred Armisen in this state. I'm like, I don't. It's too much busyness. I love to listen to it, but it's not for me to play. Anyway, I took some time to figure out what to do as a career next, and then I fell into television producing.
How did you fall into it?
The time that Luscious was sort of at its popularity, I had met Ellen DeGeneres sort of socially, and then I was dating someone who was also friends with her, and I heard she was starting a television show, and I was living out in LA, and I was kind of like, I don't know what to do. I was like doing the artist way, like trying to figure out what's next.
Oh, you did that?
Yeah.
Your morning pages?
Made pages of just okay. Like what to do. I was taking classes and all kinds of things I was interested in, and I basically got in touch with Ellen, and she had her executive producers call me and have a lunch, which is a very LA thing to do, but it actually was wonderful. And I went to lunch with her executive producers. This is before the show, her show started. And they just like kind of asked me about my background and what I was interested in. And it turns out that when you're a drummer in a band and you're paying attention and you're not like fucked up on drugs or drunk all the time, you can actually you're learning a lot about how to put on a television show or a show. You're a producer in a lot of ways.
You're learning how to manage different personalities.
Yeah, you're learning how to deal with the technical side of things and how show works and how you like want your set list to be and how you want to look and what the stage lighting is and what the sound's going to be and what to say in an interview that's going to make it interesting to people or just sort of the holistic side of putting yourself out there. So a lot of these skills, I didn't realize these were skills. I really transferred into being a television producer. So basically they we're starting the show. We need people to do, it's a job called a researcher, which is basically coming up. When they book a celebrity on a show, you write a packet of information about that person, and you try to find things that are going to be funny for Ellen to talk about and be entertaining to the audience, and you have to be able to write in Ellen's voice. And they gave me like a test packet to do, and they were like, wow, you're the least experienced person, but you've written in Ellen's voice amazingly well. So on the other side of all of this, besides loving music, I also love comedy, and I grew up loving like classic comedy and comedians and sitcoms, and another thing I loved, and another reason why I really connected with the Beastie Boys too, because they were just comedians, they were hilarious, and we all loved the same like Monty Python and Saturday Night Live and all that stuff. So anyway, they gave me a job as a researcher, and after a couple of years I was producing celebrity segment interviews, which is what I still do to this day. I worked at the Ellen's show from the beginning for like 6 years, and then I worked a bunch of other shows. I work for James Corden at the moment, which is great. And, you know, still play music, but it's, again, sort of a hobby, I guess, more than anything, here and there, record, but, and Luscious plays every once in a while.
Do you get the same creative satisfaction from producing that you got from playing drums? Or that you get from playing drums?
I think it's, I do get creative satisfaction when things go well. I mean, I think it's not the same. I think drumming, you know, it's such a physical experience. But, you know, I certainly get pleasure out of when I produce a segment that gets a ton of laughs or a ton of hits on YouTube or pick up in, you know, people.com or what, like, you know, I definitely get excited about. Or talking to somebody who I really admire and getting to pick their brain and figure out what's going to be funny on television. I love that.
It was Saturday night, you were riding your bike. I knew it would be about you and me. I was looking at you, you were seeing me too. Now you and me, we got something good.
How did you decide to have a child?
So the woman I started seeing out here when I first moved to LA, we had him together. She was, when we first got together, I already knew that she wanted to have a kid. So I sort of got into this relationship knowing that she was like on the kid train and I needed to either get on or get off, but I got on. Had him, I physically had him. And then we split up after when he was about 5. And now I live with a woman. She has also 2 kids. She has a daughter who's Leo's age, who's 12, and then a son who's 14. So we have a sort of Brady Bunch situation with kids coming in and out.
Do you have Leo like half of the time?
Yeah, half the time. I've split custody with my ex. And we live nearby, and it's all good. You know, yeah, everybody in Luscious Jackson had kids pretty quickly after we got off tour. We all have kids around similar ages, which I think is just, you know, something we all wanted to do. And
it seems like you benefited from growing up with a lot of independence. And I think especially from folks I know that are raising kids here in LA, but just in this current paradigm, it's harder to give kids that amount of freedom right now?
Oh, for sure. I mean, I'm just even thinking about going to see. So in this note that I wrote to my friend about going to see the show at CBGB's, I described the band and how cute they were, and they had a girl playing drum, all this stuff. But also, Clem Burke is sitting at a table drinking beer, smoking pot, and doing coke. And I was like, "That's how cool is that?" And of course, I'm 13. I don't know any better. And I can't even imagine my son who's 12 and a half in a year from now going to a club where there's people openly doing drugs like in front of him. You know, it's crazy to think of it. I mean,
but you turned out great.
Thank you. Yes.
I wonder if there's something lost by not letting the kids go out into the world in that way.
I mean, I had a discussion with my ex about Leo's other mom about, whether it's okay for him to, he's going to be a counselor in training at summer camp starting tomorrow. And they have an option to either bring your own lunch or to cross this big busy street to the Vaughn supermarket and buy lunch. But you have to give them permission to do that, which is kind of crazy.
I mean, when I was 13, I was taking the bus to work.
Yeah, I mean, I was.
I was not a latchkey kid, you know, but I actually liked doing all that stuff. I feel like...
Yeah, I think it's great for self-esteem.
And it also was like why DIY made so much sense to me.
You know, it was also, I was raised by a single mom and that was just the way it had to be. We had to take care of ourselves. We were doing the supermarket shopping and laundry and all that stuff. But now it's just like to get him to figure out how to turn the stove on to heat up some frozen food is just like a whole struggle. But yes, I'm sure things are being lost. However, these kids have such an amazing tool of the internet, which mm-hmm. is something that, you know, we didn't have, which, you know, certainly made us leave our houses and go to the record store to find the band or to see the flyer on the wall or find the fanzine or make a fanzine. Yes. You know, now they can just click through a million things to find something amazing. And it would have been amazing to have the internet, I guess.
Maybe. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know either. But yeah, when I was 11, I was in a Broadway show, and I was leaving school.
Okay, which show were you in?
It was off Broadway for, I don't know, 6 months or something, and then it moved to Broadway. And I was like in seventh grade, going to school.
Did you have a union card and stuff
at that
point? Yeah,
I joined Equity, and I would leave school early on Wednesdays to go to do a matinee and we'd do 8 shows a week. And I was living in Brooklyn, and I would take a taxi home every night by myself. And we'd like in between shows, this was up in Broadway district of Manhattan, which is around Times Square. If we had a matinee to kill time in between, I would just walk over to the...
Catch a peep show?
No, not quite. I wasn't interested in that. It was the pinball arcades, like all the arcades.
Oh, yeah.
And just like play pinball for hours by myself. So the whole experience was maybe like a year or so. The show was nominated for some Tony Awards. We performed at the Tonys. It was like this whirlwind. And then, I don't know, then it was done. And then I guess a couple years after that is when I discovered, you know, this whole music scene and performing in that capacity, I guess. But it wasn't something like, same with music. Like, it was never like wanted to be the star or the front person or the, you know, the lead. I liked sort of being a part of this group. Same as choir.
And
like,
same as being a producer. Yeah. You're facilitating someone else.
I like being kind of running it from behind, you know, as a drummer, you're just basically controlling everything that's happening, sitting down, which is also I enjoy. I think a lot of producers or a lot of drummers are producers. Like I don't think that's an uncommon jump to make. I've met a lot of producers on television who are drummers or were drummers.
I just co-produced Fred's comedy special last year. That was the first thing I ever tried to produce.
Yeah.
They just like brought me in to help, and then they're like, well, actually you're being a producer, so you get to be a producer on this. You're right. Like, that same skill set was very easily transferable. Do you worry about anything right now?
I would say I'm a pretty mellow person. I've learned in life that worrying doesn't change anything.
That's true.
There were times definitely, certainly in the band years, where I wish I had known all this, that losing sleep over shit, it's just going to make you tired. It's not going to make you figure out how to do it better.
Right. It's not always easy to will yourself not to worry, though.
Yeah, but I didn't understand, you can't really control what anyone else is doing. You can kind of only control what you're doing. You hope you can be a good influence and a good person and put good vibes out there. And I tried to just approach life in a very sort of, everything's going to work out. It's worked out so far. And if something goes wrong, I can handle it. And if I can't handle it, I'm surrounded by people who will help me handle it. And I'm really lucky to have a partner who I love and adore, who loves and adores me. And we're raising kids together. And I have an ex who I can trust and I count on. And my sister is here, and now my mom's living here. Like, it's just...
Does your mom live with you?
No, she's just moved from New York. She's a old school fifth generation New Yorker, has finally been done with New York and moved to LA. Never thought I'd see the day where the whole Schellenbach clan has left New York, because we were like such diehard New Yorkers.
Do you have any creative aspirations for yourself moving forward?
I mean, I hope to keep playing music and keep working in television. I hope to keep feeling stimulated by the job that I do. I think eventually, you know, moving up in the television land and working with other people. I really enjoy my job at the moment. I think James Corden is great and the show is great. I don't know. I think I just want to continue to be inspired by the things that I do and, you know, keep playing along to keep trying to figure out what jazz, how you play jazz.
Okay. Well, I think that's a good place to end it. Let's go listen to some jazz records.
Okay.
Kate Schellenbach, thanks so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
Trap Set is produced by me, Joe Wong, along with Chris Karwowski, who also edits the program. Follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook at The Trap Set, and visit our website, thetrapset.net, to subscribe to our show for free. If you enjoyed what you heard today, please donate to our show. If you can't afford to donate, please tell a friend and give us a good rating on iTunes. Send your feedback and guest requests to thetrapset@gmail.com.